musical director and told him what was on my mind. I explained to him a little bit about Lorraine Hansberry because he didn't know her. And he captured the mood, and the song was born less than 2 days later. And that's been less than a month ago. So I really think that she gave it to me. That's what I mean when I say that.
Oh, what a lovely, precious dream.
To be young, gifted, and white.
Open your heart to what I mean.
In the whole world,
you know, there's a million boys and girls.
Simone's social commentary was not limited to the civil rights movement. The song For Women exposed the Eurocentric appearance standards imposed on Black women in America, as it explored the internalized limit of beauty that is experienced between four Black women with skin tones ranging from light to dark. She explains in her autobiography, I Put a Spell on You, that the purpose of the song was to inspire Black women to define beauty and identify for themselves without the influence of societal impositions.
My skin is black. My arms are long. My hair is woolly. And my back is strong. Strong enough to take all the pain that's been inflicted again and again and again. What do they call me? My name is Aunt Sarah.
Throughout her professional success, Ms. Simone is known to have struggled with depression and bipolar disorder, being officially diagnosed in the late 1980s. These personal issues strained her relationships with family and those around her and shaped many of her decisions. Her explosiveness was well known, including during her mainly improvised performances. Her mental health issues were not fully disclosed until after her passing.
Nina was fighting demons. She could get violent.
Hey, girl, sit down.
The change in her would be dramatic, like a switch.
Sit down.
As fragile as she was strong, as vulnerable as she was dynamic, most people are afraid to be as honest as she lived.
I've had a couple of times on stage when I really felt free.
The High Priestess of
Thorpe. That's Nina Simone.
Nina Simone.
Wait, Nina Simone.
She was a genius. She was brilliant. But she paid a huge price. People think that when she went out on stage, she became Nina Simone. My mother was Nina Simone 24/7. And that's where it became a problem.
In 1993, she settled in southern France. It is reported that she suffered from breast cancer for several years before she died in her sleep at her home on April 21st, 2003, at age 70. In her autobiography, Nina Simone writes that her function as an artist is to make people feel on a deep level. It's difficult to describe because it's not something you can analyze. To get near what it's about, you have to play it. And when you've caught it, when you've got the audience hooked, you always know because it's like electricity hanging in the air.
I think what you're trying to ask is, why am I so insistent upon giving out to them that blackness, that black power, that black pushing them to identify with black culture. I think that's what you're asking. It's I have no choice over it. In the first place, to me, we are the most beautiful creatures in the whole world, black people. I mean, and I mean that in every sense, outside and inside. And to me, we have a culture that is surpassed by no other civilization, but we don't know anything about it. So again, I think I've said this before in the same interview, I think at some time before, my job is to somehow make them curious enough or persuade them by hook or crook to get more aware of themselves and where they came from and what they are into and what is already there, and just to bring it out. This is what compels me to compel them. And I will do it by whatever means necessary.
Our panel discussion tonight, Nina Simone was an artist of enormous talent who was greatly impacted by the Black arts and Black power movements. Ms. Simone's life is often referred to as equally tragic and genius. And this evening, the panel will discuss her talent and legacy, the attempts to memorialize her home in North Carolina, and the very real struggles for women of color regarding mental health. I turn it over to Ms. Sandy Adams.
Well, my name is Sandra Adams, and I'm a member of Target for the Arts. So I'm going to stop sharing now. And I want to introduce you to some of our panelists. So our first panelist is Angela Thorpe. She has served as the director of North Carolina African American Heritage Commission since 2019, and previously was the associate director of the AAHC. She was the first African American historic interpreter at the James K. Polk State Historic Site in Pineville, North Carolina. She is one of the leaders in the combined efforts of the National Trust for Historic Preservation, the Nina Simone Project, World Monuments Fund, the North Carolina African American Heritage Commission, and the North Carolina Arts Council to preserve Simone's childhood home in Tryon, North Carolina. Also joining us is Carly Jones. Carly Prentice Jones is a theater artist, singer, arts advocate, and cultural activist. She is a versatile artist performing in opera, musical theater, as well as in classic and contemporary theater. She attended Miami University in Oxford, Ohio, where she earned a Bachelor of Music in Vocal Performance, a Bachelor of Arts in Black Music History, and a minor in arts management. She serves as the music director for the North Carolina Arts Council, managing grants for music organizations and artist fellowships for songwriters and composers. She is also a key player in the combined effort in North Carolina to restore Simone's childhood home. And last but not least, we have Sierra Patterson. Sierra Patterson is a young woman from inner city Baltimore, Maryland, inspired to pursue a career in psychology by the pain she observed in her community. She received her undergraduate degree in psychology from UMBC in 2011 and immediately began working in community mental health. After working for Mosaic Community Services for 5 years, she decided to take the next step to become a therapist. Sierra graduated from Johns Hopkins University with a master's degree in clinical mental health counseling and received her LGPC licensure. In addition, she qualified for a national certified counselor certification. Currently, Sierra works as a therapist under Heather Dupree with Shepherd Pratt and is working toward her LCPC licensure. She hopes to specialize in adults with chronic mental illness and trauma therapy. So I want to ask if everyone wants to put their choice for viewing on speaker view. That way they could make sure that they can see everyone as we're talking. And I'm going to start, if I can, Angela, with you. And I want to ask you, in your position with the North Carolina African American Heritage Commission, can you tell me a little bit about what you do and what Nina Simone's connection is to North Carolina?
Absolutely. So I'll start by, again, talking about the commission, kind of highlighting some of our other projects as well as a means towards helping to frame our work around the Nina Simone home in Tryon, North Carolina. So the North Carolina African American Heritage Commission is what we call a division of the North Carolina Department of Natural and Cultural Resources. So a lead estate agency, and under that big umbrella department, it's where you find the North Carolina Arts Council or the State Art Museum or even the State Zoo. So anything to do with arts, culture, natural resources, again, those are my sister divisions. Now at the commission, we hold it as our mission to preserve, promote, and protect North Carolina's African American history, arts, and culture for all people. And for us, that shows up in a couple of different ways. I would note that first and foremost, we work to help amplify Black stories. So I work with my team of two additional staff members to put together resources, programs, exhibits, and other experiences that help to showcase the breadth and depth of the African-American experience in North Carolina. For example, some of you might be familiar with, or if you are not already, I encourage you to get familiar with the North Carolina Green Book Project. That is an effort that the commission led to document the over 300 Green Book sites in our state. So the sites that were listed in the Negro Motorist Green Book, and that resulted in a traveling exhibit and a web portal. So again, that's that kind of amplification and resource development work. We also work to offer professional development opportunities to a group that I call African American Heritage Practitioners. So that is people like me who do the work of Black history, or people like Carly who do the work of helping to amplify and highlight the work of Black artists and culture workers across the state. So we offer workshops to people, we help develop students. I'm really just trying to create a way forward for more people to do the work of Black history and Black art in our state. The final way that our work typically shows up is by something that we call technical assistance. And this is a really, really broad category. This can look like something that happened a couple of weeks ago, somebody picking up the phone and calling me and saying, hey, I am going through my father's estate and he has boxes and boxes of all of these papers documenting his journey of being a preacher in North Carolina. What do I do? That can also look like projects like the Nina Simone Home, a historic space, a sacred space that perhaps is falling into disrepair, or you know, an owner might need guidance around what to do with it, how to preserve it. I can hop in and help people think through solutions and strategies to help preserve African American materials, spaces, and stories. And again, this is where the Nina Simone Home comes in. Now, Nina Simone, as we noted in the intro video, was born in Tryon, North Carolina in the 1930s, in 1933. But again, she was six of eight children. So the home that she grew up in, of course, existed before 1933. We think it was probably built sometime in the 20s. And so at this point, the home is probably about 100 years old, right? The actual structure itself. And at a certain point, Nina Simone left the home. At a certain point, her family left the home, and it went through multiple owners over time. And a couple of people tried to get a hold of it, tried to restore it and do work to repair it because it was kind of falling apart, but those efforts kind of fell through the cracks. And so in 2017, a group of four Black artists from New York City decided to come together to purchase the home for about $95,000. And if any of you all are on the home buying market, whether it is a regular home nowadays or a historic home, we know that $95,000 is not a lot of money. However, I think that there's something to be said for it. It took four people from outside of our state to say, hey, this is something that we need to save, and we're going to pull our resources together again to secure that $95,000 to make sure this home does not fall into ill hands or ill intentions. And again, that's exactly what happened. Now, I should note that the artists never had any intention of continuing to own the home. They just wanted to hold on to it until somebody could figure out exactly what was going to happen to it. And that is when a large national organization called the National Trust for Historic Preservation popped into action. The National Trust for Historic Preservation helps to preserve historic spaces all across the country. They are responsible for helping to preserve everything from Madam C.J. Walker's big, big mansion, Villa Luaro, to Route 66 out west. And so again, they preserve sacred spaces all over the country that connect all sorts of stories and rich histories. The National Trust for Historic Preservation understood that a lot of partners needed to come to the table to help figure out a future for the Nina Simone home. And that's where the commission comes in. We were one of those partners that was called upon, on one hand, to help amplify what was happening around the home, to share across the state, hey, everyone, four artists bought this home, we're going to be preserving it, and we're going to be thinking about a future for the home. So again, we spread the word in a number of diverse ways across the state. We also have been leaders at the forefront of figuring out what the future of the home is going to be. I'll break this process down just a bit further. So in terms of that home, again, we've got that building that was held for $95,000, but there's so much that needs to happen, right? On one hand, the home needs to be restored. When you go to the home, or when you went to the home in 2018, there's glass missing from the windows. There are pieces missing from the roof. There are holes in the floorboard. And so you had to think of a way to restore that in a way that would not harm the home's historical integrity. That work costs money, right, to do that historically accurately. We wanted to think about how to rehabilitate the home. So more than just fixing those broken windows and the roof and the floors, if the home one day is going to be accessible to the public, what will that look like? How do you install plumbing? How do you install electricity? How do you install insulation? All of that work costs money. And also, how do you do that work, once again, in a way that does not mess with the historical integrity of the home? The final piece of this work, again, is thinking through, what is this home going to be? And people have a lot of ideas. Some folks want it to be a museum. Some folks want it to be a studio for artists. Some people want it to be a place where, again, you can give walking tours and go look at exhibits. Other people want it to be a quiet and contemplative space. And so we have been at the forefront of helping to think through what the future of that home is going to look like. That has involved a lot of internal strategy sessions. That's involved a lot of talking to folks across the state. That has also included talking to a lot of people in Tryon, North Carolina. I should also note that the home is in a residential area, so there are neighbors there. And so that use conversation ultimately will affect the people who live right next door. And so again, that is a bit about what our work has looked like. primarily since 2018, so about a year after the home was purchased. I'll note that the final piece of this work is making sure that that home is protected, right? So as development affects many of our communities across the state, and as gentrification affects many of our communities across the state, strategizing around how to make sure that development and or gentrification does not encroach upon that home. And so protections actually as of this past September have been put in place to ensure that anything that happens around the home will not affect the home. So again, if a developer wants to come and build, Nina Simone's home as is protected, which is something that is very, very important to this space. You asked a bit about how Nina Simone is connected to North Carolina. Well, again, she was born in Tryon, again, in this neighborhood that I described. The home, you all, is so beautiful. It's moving. It's what I would describe as modest. Imagine eight people growing up in a two-bedroom, three-room home. Again, that is where Nina Simone was born and raised. And I said eight people, that's eight kids, you all. So eight kids plus the parents. Again, it would have been a tight squeeze, but I like to think that it's that energy, that lifestyle, if you will, that helped make Nina Simone who she was in Tryon, North Carolina. So I will pause there for what I think is going to be my next question.
Okay, I thought this might be a good point to share the video so that people could actually get a look at what the home looks like. So if I'm gonna share my screen again.
Nina Simone, legendary musician, social justice champion, and global inspiration. But the High Priestess of Soul had humble beginnings, and the place where it all began is threatened. Hi, I'm Brent Leggs with the National Trust for Historic Preservation. We work to save historic places, and right now we are working to save Nina Simone's childhood home in Tryon, North Carolina. This three-room house might not seem like much, but it's here that Nina fell in love with music and learned to play the piano. It's here that she first experienced racial discrimination that would shape her life and commitment to racial equality. And it's here that she began to find her voice in art and in activism. Here, in this modest home, is where it all started. Today, with your help, we can make sure that her unique voice continues to inspire and motivate people through her childhood home. The house is currently vacant, in disrepair, and lacking any interpretation or preservation protections. Work is underway to restore and protect it, but we need your help to cross the finish line. When you donate to the National Trust campaign, you'll help fund critical restoration work in Nina Simone's childhood home. And depending on your donation, you can get exclusive Nina Simone inspired perks, including t-shirts, enamel pins, prints, and postcards that will let you show the world your love for her music and for her message. Help save the place where Nina Simone began. Become a part of her remarkable legacy.
So that gives us a look at what the home looks like. So I wondered, and Carly, you can jump in here too. Through your efforts, what I know that her family has been involved in some of the efforts, her daughter Lisa, who we saw in the intro video. Can you tell me a little bit about how the family's been involved?
Certainly. So as I shared, our work to help North Carolinians mainly understand what is going on with the home has looked different, has been really diverse and creative. I'll note that Nina Simone's younger sister was involved in the kickoff campaign that announced that the National Trust for Historic Preservation would be raising funds to restore the home. And so that's one way that the family has been involved. Carly and I also worked for about a year on a project that was a huge labor of love. Again, all of those things that I described, from strategy sessions to the painting that you saw, to fixing the windows and the shingles on the roof, every piece of that costs money, and historic preservation is incredibly expensive. And so we helped to contribute to a fundraising campaign by actually producing a benefit concert in partnership with the North Carolina Museum of Art. That benefit concert enabled us to bring Nina Simone's only child, Lisa Simone, from Paris to North Carolina to pay tribute to her mother by singing her songs. And Carly, I'll toss it to you from here to share a little bit more.
Sure. Yeah. As Angela said, you know, we're colleagues and we're within the same department, which is the Department of Natural and Cultural Resources. And so our divisions are what we call kind of sister divisions. And so Angela had already started this great work with the Commission and the National Trust for Historic Preservation on the Nina Simone campaign. And as she explained, they really wanted to reach communities. They wanted to reach people in North Carolina. A lot of folks in North Carolina weren't even aware that Nina Simone was from North Carolina. And at that, you know, she's from this small town out west in Tryon. Many people, when they think of Nina Simone, they think of Baltimore, they think of Philly, they think of New York, because she's such a global icon. But she did get her start in North Carolina, and much of her musical roots, which I'm sure we'll get to in a bit, are from her upbringing here in North Carolina. So so Angela reached out to me because our job at the North Carolina Arts Council is to be in touch with artists of all kinds across the state of North Carolina and help support them and through grants and funding. So, and we had just kicked off a campaign called Come Here, H-E-A-R, Come Here in C, which play on words, was a year of music and celebrating the musical traditions of North Carolina. Many folks don't know that the roots of many American genres are in North Carolina. John Coltrane, Thelonious Monk, Nina Simone, Roberta Flack, George Clinton, goes on and on, are all from North Carolina. And so it was perfect timing for us to be able to work with the African American Heritage Commission on this project. And to really, we were working with some major media outlets on our huge statewide campaign. It was a campaign, you know, that was also kind of, you know, supported very publicly by our governor at the time. So it was really a great opportunity for us to utilize that campaign to get the work of the African American Heritage Commission out there, and also the National Trust. So yeah, Angela and I were just, you know, we were brainstorming, okay, what can we do? What can we do to get statewide awareness of Nina Simone's legacy and the fact that she is from North Carolina and there's this home, and what can we do? And we also have a partner, the North Carolina Museum of Art, which is a huge, kind of the gem of all museums here in North Carolina. It has a huge amphitheater space, and we thought, and it's in Raleigh, in the capital of the state, and we partnered with them and said, you know, what if we could bring Lisa Simone, Nina Simone's daughter and only child, here for a benefit concert? Angela wasn't connected to Lisa Simone. I wasn't either. This was kind of our top choice. And she was living up in Paris, just like her mother ended up living in Paris at the end. And she also has a career, a Broadway career, and now also jazz, and very incredible performer, like her mother. And Angela and we ended up talking to her on the phone and making it happen. And it was a really beautiful that it didn't happen as simply as I just stated. It took a lot of work and a lot of meetings. And we actually had a benefit concert at the North Carolina Museum of Art. They were arrangements of all of her tunes with a big band. So I'm not sure if you all are familiar with big band music, but picture, you know, brass, lots of brass instruments, fills up the entire stage. And this big band was comprised of North Carolina musicians. We also happen to have an incredible HBCU here, Central University, which is has a world-known jazz education program. The Marsalis brothers are very, Branford Marsalis, to be exact, is very integral in that program. And we worked with Lenora Helm, who is a professor there, to get a big band together of artists, not just students, but jazz artists from across the state. And it was an incredible night. We actually raised, and it was not just one night, it was a whole weekend of programming that we had. And we flew Lisa Simone in, and we had a weekend of programming, including the film. You saw a little piece of her film that she produced about her mother there. We incorporated other artists like Dare Coulter. That beautiful image, that painting that you saw, was a North Carolina artist and muralist, Dare Coulter, who's worked quite a bit with the African-American Heritage Commission. And so we were able to really infuse many North Carolina musicians and artists into this labor of love to raise the funds for kind of that first tier of fundraising with the National Trust for Historic Preservation. As Angela touched on earlier, it's really important for the National Trust to get statewide stakeholders, not just national ones, and community stakeholders and try-on. So, you know, this was our way of pulling together many stakeholders and to have a huge awareness, a piece of that awareness campaign. And so it was a very successful night. We actually raised over $60,000. Is that right, Angela? Yeah, over $60,000 for that first kind of tier of the fundraising for the home. And that is not the only thing that we've done in this awareness campaign. As Angela said, we've done quite a few things to infuse the arts in this campaign. When the home was actually deemed a national treasure, which was a very big deal, only the second national treasure in the state of North Carolina. We actually brought four different musicians to the site, and you know, National Geographic was there, and all of these journalists. And as we were planning for it, we said, well, we can't have a press conference about Nina Simone and no music. So we actually brought down four different women that are North Carolina musicians. And as you saw, you know, Nina Simone's music is so broad, and she was such a prolific artist that it's hard to find, you can't really find another Nina Simone. There's no other Nina Simone, right? So we brought four different artists that could emulate parts of her style. And my favorite part of that weekend, which was before we got this, I'm going backwards. That was the kind of first piece that we did before the big concert in Raleigh. But my favorite part of that weekend was when, and Angela touched on this, her sister, her younger sister came to help with the kickoff. And also I think my favorite musical portion of that was when they performed Four Women, which was, I actually got to participate as a singer in that, which was nice. Wow. So Yeah, and then we had a one-woman show that toured HBCUs, starring Yolanda Rabin, who's an incredible R&B artist here in North Carolina, opened up for the Isley Brothers and such. She's fabulous. And we also have enlisted Vanessa Ferguson, who is a singer out of Greensboro. You may have seen her on The Voice. And we actually brought her to the home to do perform a few of Nina's songs, which you can now see on YouTube within the home, as a part of the Come Here North Carolina campaign. So we, you know, we've done quite a bit of work to get the word out. You know, I am a true believer that the arts is a connector. The arts can be used as a tool, as Nina believed. I mean, it is a powerful tool. She used that in her activism work to speak. Angela and I both believe that the arts is a way to really connect community and kind of cut through to people in a way that, you know, you just can't when you just simply, you know, see an email or something. You know, you've got, you know, so we were thinking if we get in touch with all of these constituents at young people at HBCUs and the big, you know, performance with Lisa, you know, Simone at the Museum of Art. And we, you know, then we would be able to get in touch with a broad base of stakeholders.
Thank you very much. So we're gonna transition a little bit. It was interesting to hear you talk about that little slip of the movie we saw with Lisa, our daughter, because she talked a little bit about some of the challenges Nina Simone went through. And so I'm gonna turn it over to Gina so that she can sort of talk to that.
Evening. As part of our women's healthcare and wellness, we have tonight Ms. Patterson, who is a licensed therapist, who's gonna speak to us about the disorder, bipolar disorder. Because as much as we can talk about Ms. Simone's, her talent, her advocacy and her activism, running parallel is the fact that she suffered from this condition as well as the depression. I did read an article that talked to her and called her a bipolar savant, which means she suffered from the disorder, but her genius and her craft was still allowed to shine through. Even though I'm a healthcare worker, I will say before I turn it over to Ms. Patterson is, in society, I think we throw that term bipolar around too casually. And so I do hope that this next presentation, you'll be able to see exactly what is going on in a bipolar person's world. And maybe you won't use it as readily. And I admit I'm guilty of it. So Ms. Patterson, I'm gonna turn it over to you because I know you do have a presentation.
Yes, ma'am. And before I start, I want to go off script and just say, oh my God, I am in awe at just being in the presence of so many wonderful women. This is amazing. Thank you guys for all of the work that you've done for like preserving Nina's, just her reputation and her legacy. It's amazing. Just had to get that off my chest. So I will share my screen. And there we go. All righty. So hello again, everyone. My name is Sierra. I am an LGPC therapist with Shepherd Pratt in Maryland. And again, thank you so much for inviting me to speak on this topic, which is actually very dear to my heart. One of the reasons I decided to pursue therapy as a career was due to a desire to increase awareness of mental illness in the Black community. So I am definitely honored to have an opportunity to share my knowledge of this topic with you guys tonight, with you ladies tonight. So let's begin by defining bipolar disorder. Bipolar disorder is actually a set of disorders that involve dramatic, distressing fluctuations in mood and affect that disrupt a person's ability to live their lives normally. Symptom clusters are often defined as depressive episodes, manic episodes, and hypomanic episodes. The manic and depressive symptoms are where the original name for this disorder, manic depression, originates from. They called it manic depression many, many years ago and then switched to bipolar disorder, I want to say maybe about 60 or 70 years ago. Although there is no cure for bipolar disorder, there are several treatment options that can help manage symptoms. A big reason why people often do not seek treatment is that it often feels hopeless since there isn't a cure. But people who are diagnosed with bipolar disorder can actually live a normal, healthy life when it's well managed. So I mentioned that there are symptom clusters and that bipolar disorder is actually a set of disorders. So first, the symptom clusters are separated into mania, hypomania, depression, and mixed states. Mania is the highs that people experience when they have bipolar disorder. People often mistake this for feeling happy, but it's actually more than just that simple happiness that we, without bipolar disorder, may feel. In a manic episode, people are often experience irritability, impulsiveness, insomnia, and just grandiose beliefs about themselves. Mania can come with increased self-esteem, increased goal-directed behaviors. So that's like really like, I want to achieve this goal and I'm going to go do it now. And increased creativity. So it can be really easy to see how mania can be misconstrued as a positive experience. But a lot of times people ruin their lives during manic episodes. The next one is hypomania, which is kind of like mania, but it's a little bit less severe. The risky impulsive behavior still occurs, but it's a bit less destructive. And the increase in self-esteem, irritability, insomnia, and other symptoms occur as well. But it often does not completely disrupt a person's life, though it may hurt their social lives and their relationships with others around them. And finally, there's the depressive symptoms, which I feel like a lot of people are more familiar with these days than they used to be. Depressive symptoms, people experience that sadness, that loss of motivation, sometimes suicidal thoughts, low self-esteem, and trouble with their sleep and appetite. Another rarely talked about symptom of depression is actually apathy, where people just don't care about anything and they just can't get up out of bed. Sometimes people will experience mixed episodes of both depression and mania. And a lot of times there's no pattern to these episodes. People can experience what we call rapid cycling, which is where they may go from manic to depressed in maybe like a day or two, or episodes can actually last for months at a time. So someone can be manic for months. That said, bipolar disorder is separated in the DSM, which is the diagnostic manual that mental health professionals use, into three different disorders. They are bipolar 1, bipolar 2, and then cyclothymia. Bipolar 1 consists of mainly the manic episodes, though people do experience the depressive episodes as well. Bipolar 2 is mainly depressive with more of the hypomanic symptoms. And cyclothymia is actually a less severe version of bipolar 2, where a person may not experience any extreme dysfunction in their daily lives. Bipolar 1 often requires hospitalization and intensive levels of support due to the risk-taking behaviors that people will engage in. But people with bipolar 2 often experience more severe depressive episodes. And in the next slide, I've compiled some common myths about bipolar disorder. Often people will assume that the highs and lows that people experience in bipolar disorder are just the normal variations in mood that everybody has. And we all go through mood swings. And this is not accurate because the mood fluctuations in bipolar disorder are extreme to the point of dysfunction. People with the mood fluctuations are severe and extreme, and that causes distress and pain for the sufferer and for those around them. Imagine being in a room with your mom and she was really happy and she was like, we're gonna go out and get ice cream. And the next moment she's really mad at you for something small. And then the next she's crying in her room. It really impacts the way that they're able to interact with others. Sometimes people believe that people with bipolar disorder are actually dangerous to society. And this is actually not true. People with bipolar disorder are actually more likely to hurt themselves and not others. However, they can often seem erratic, impulsive, or even abusive if they are not managing their symptoms well. And with treatment, they can live fairly normal lives, which leads to the next point. Again, a lot of times people feel that there are no treatments for bipolar disorder, but we actually have a lot of different ways to treat this disorder. Just because there's no cure doesn't mean that this disorder cannot be managed. And that's a really important point to hammer home for people, especially when they first get diagnosed. The fourth myth is a common assumption that bipolar disorder and other mental illnesses simply require more willpower, more strength, more faith, or any of the above to improve symptoms. And while faith and willpower is definitely really important when it comes to sticking with treatment options, it's important to remember that bipolar disorder is an illness similar to diabetes. Lifestyle changes can help, and they do help, but it also requires intervention from professionals like me. It isn't a moral failing, it's a biopsychosocial disorder caused by genetics, cognitions, behaviors, environment, and many more. And speaking of the causes of bipolar disorder, some people assume that bipolar disorder is caused by drug use. And people with bipolar disorder will often self-medicate with alcohol and drugs. So alcohol and drug use disorders are often comorbid with bipolar disorder. However, it's not ultimately caused by the drugs and the alcohol. It's more like the other way around. Bipolar disorder tends to increase the tendency to seek drugs and alcohol to soothe that pain that they're feeling. But it is important to remember that alcohol and drug use does trigger symptoms, and it can worsen symptoms for people who already have the diagnosis. And finally, a lot of people assume that children cannot be diagnosed with bipolar disorder. And that's 100% false. Although therapists are very cautious in diagnosing someone who's under 18 with bipolar disorder, it is definitely a possibility. And kids experience many of the same mental illnesses that adults do, including bipolar disorder. And mental health professionals, again, we're really careful about these illnesses because the diagnosis tends to stick. So we don't want to stick a child with bipolar if in reality they may have just been having some attention issues. And again, the presentation may differ between children and adults, but ultimately, yes, children can and do suffer from mental illness. So here I have some treatment options. I view them in terms of two main categories, one being like therapeutic interventions and one being the medication interventions. Therapy offers many different types of options, though the main go-to for many professionals and clients is often cognitive behavioral therapy, or CBT. It's a form of therapy that has a lot of empirical evidence and research-based evidence supporting its efficacy. So many organizations kind of default to it. And under the CBT umbrella is also DBT, which stands for dialectical behavioral therapy. DBT focuses on mindfulness and acceptance and is often used to help clients improve their ability to tolerate distressing emotions. DBT is one of my favorite forms of therapy myself, even though I have not been trained in it just yet, I intend to. And these therapy is often beneficial for families of those with bipolar disorder as well. And there is family therapy and support groups to help family members who are dealing with a loved one that's suffering through this disorder. And support groups often are really, really great because they also not only do they help family members learn how to support their loved one, but it also helps family members learn how to support themselves while they're dealing with their own trauma from seeing a loved one suffer from a mental illness. And two options for treatment that Shepherd Pratt actually offers are day programs and residential programs. Day programs are places where people with severe mental illness can go to participate in psychoeducational groups and receive case management services. Case management services often help people who are not as independent be able to access services like going to the doctors or just getting groceries sometimes. Residential programs are homes where people with mental illnesses can receive additional in-home support to help them develop their daily living skills. Both are very helpful for clients whose symptoms may be a bit too severe for them to function independently, but who are not a danger to themselves or anybody else. And finally, another option is actually ECT or electroconvulsive therapy. This is often a really controversial option because when we think of ECT, we think of an unwilling participant being strapped to a chair with like things all over their faces and a thing in their mouth and they're being electrocuted into compliance. However, during ECT, clients are often under general anesthesia and the electrical pulses are very light and is only applied to certain spots of the brain to kind of reset the symptoms. I'm not a specialist in ECT, so I don't know exactly how it works. I just know that from my experiences, I've seen that for the people who need it, it does work. And a lot of times it is a painless procedure. And there are some side effects like headaches and like temporary memory loss. And it's important to remember that ECT is not an option for everybody. And it's typically reserved for people who are very severe cases that are not responding well to other treatment options like medications, which I'm going to speak about now. The medication interventions are various. It's hard for me to talk about the medication interventions because my license is not in medication management. But because of like the history of my career, I do know a bit about some of them, but I won't delve too deep into the medications. I'll just say that the main medications used for bipolar disorder are mood stabilizers, antipsychotics, and sometimes antidepressants. There are some examples of medications for each category, like lithium, lamotrigine or Lamictal, and there's also Zyprexa and Abilify. And those are pretty first-line treatments these days when it comes to medication management for people with bipolar disorder. Many of these medications are very safe, but they can have side effects that are really unpleasant, So if someone does choose medication management as a treatment option, they need to communicate actively with their psychiatrist about what they are experiencing, because not every medication works for every person. So one person may respond very well to lithium and their symptoms could be completely managed with it. And then another person has awful side effects from it. So, bipolar disorder, along with other mental illnesses, actually can have a huge impact on our communities. A great example of this impact is seen in Nina Simone and in the relationship she had with those around her. Due to the difficulty she experienced in managing her symptoms, Nina was seen by family and associates as volatile and even abusive at times. But she was also passionate, fiery, creative, and just intense in a really beautiful way. And it was both her blessing and her curse. And this is true for many people with bipolar disorder that is not managed well. One of the things that really stood out to me in the introductory video was the fact that she was diagnosed with bipolar disorder, I believe in the 80s. And that's a long time to suffer. And remember that people who are kids can suffer from these symptoms. So who knows how long she went before this was noticed and actually treated. An untreated bipolar disorder often causes difficulties in interpersonal relationships, resulting in, again, abusive or generally dysfunctional homes. The person suffering from bipolar disorder is just as likely to be the abuser as they are to be the one being abused or taken advantage of. And this is especially true for people who have really severe bipolar disorder that their families don't understand or their families use to get money, which is a common issue. This results in trauma and adverse life events for the entire family. Another important aspect of bipolar disorder in our community is that there is an increased risk of substance abuse and addiction, as discussed earlier. People with bipolar disorder are likely to self-medicate because they don't know what else to do. And generally, people with bipolar disorder are at risk for more physical health conditions as well, such as metabolic diseases like heart disease and diabetes. And finally, as mentioned before, suicide attempts are common in those with bipolar disorder. Bipolar disorder is generally associated with a high morbidity and a high mortality rate, and the likelihood of at least one suicide attempt is extremely high. So what can we do? And one of the first things that I think of when I think of what can we as a community do about the issues that bipolar disorder presents and for us in general is to decrease the stigma in seeking mental health resources and increasing awareness of those resources. I often wonder how different people like Nina Simone would have been if she was able to receive and adhere to effective treatment sooner in her life. Her relationships with those around her may have been more positive. And in these recent years, we have seen similar behavior and issues with people like Kanye West, who is suffering from poorly managed bipolar disorder. Secondly, I believe that education regarding mental health, science, and medicine is a necessity to improve people's understanding of these conditions and how they're treated. The Black community particularly has experienced a lot of betrayal and discrimination and trauma at the hands of medical professionals. So it's not an easy task to reduce the mistrust that we as a community feel towards science. And I believe this is where some of the educational pieces come in, because the more we know, the more we can make informed health decisions for ourselves so that doctors have to listen to us because we know what we're talking about. Another important aspect of increasing education is also increasing our mental health vocabulary. While doing this presentation, there were studies that I found that showed that Black people often describe their symptoms using physical health terms, such as I have a headache or I have a stomach ache, instead of the mental health terms that we would typically associate with I'm feeling stressed. And this often causes doctors to treat for medical concerns instead of referring to a therapist or a psychiatrist. And finally, access to healthcare is severely lacking in the Black community in general. Mental health care especially can be difficult to find and then even harder to pay for. Many nonprofit organizations such as Shepherd Pratt take health insurance such as Medicaid and Medicare, but a lot of private practices don't. And it's the private practices that we really think about when we think about mental health. We think about going into a nice fancy doctor office and laying back on a couch and talking with someone about how we're feeling and then getting up and paying $100 copay and leaving. And that's not all there is to mental health. There are resources, but a lot of times people just don't know about them. And this makes mental health feel like it's a luxury instead of a necessity, like a primary care doctor would be. So finally, I've included the references that I used for my own memory, other than my own memory. I mean, if anyone is interested in reading some of the articles that I found regarding bipolar disorder, also I had to reference our diagnostic manual since a lot of the information I grabbed was from there. And I've also listed some resources that is available for you and your loved ones. Unfortunately, most of these are Maryland resources since I am stationed in Maryland, specifically Baltimore City and Baltimore County. But there are a few that are important for anyone, anywhere, such as NAMI, which is a national organization, and the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, which is available for everyone. So when I showed this presentation to my higher ups, they were like, you need to include some stuff about Shepherd Pratt. So I'm like, all right. So this is a little bit more information about our organization. Shepherd Pratt is a really old organization that's been around for a lot of different years, like a long time, but it's very recently kind of branched out and kind of acquired other mental health resources under its umbrella. So now Shepherd Pratt is more than just a hospital. It has outpatient mental health centers. I used to work for one in terms of day programs, residential programs, clinics, et cetera. It also has the crisis walk-in clinic where you can go straight to this location and you will be seen immediately. I do believe that it's 24 hours. If not, then obviously they would just kind of send you to the ER. But then there's also now the virtual walk-in clinic because of, you know, COVID and everything that we've had to do in terms of readjusting our lives. Shepherd Pratt now offers a virtual clinic. So that concludes my presentation. Thank you all for listening and just being interested in this topic. Like I said, it's a topic that's really near and dear to me. So I hope that I was able to help you guys understand bipolar disorder a little bit better. And I believe that now I'm open for a few minutes of questions. Feel free to ask me anything that may have crossed your mind during the presentation.
Ms. Patterson, what we're going to do is have people put questions in the chat. We're going to finish, and then at the end, we'll circle back to have those questions answered.
All right.
You did very excellent presentation, and I do think we've learned a lot. And just keep in mind how, when you think about, as we go on still talking about Nina Simone, what was going on in her life at the time that she was making all her beautiful music. So we thank you, and I turn this back over to Sam.
And I just wanted to add one additional thing too. The trailer that you saw, What Happened, Miss Simone, which is on Netflix, I think is something, first of all, you should definitely watch, and something that may have a lot more meaning now, because Lisa talks very specifically about how it was dealing with her mother. And you hear very specifically at the end of her life in France, when she would not take medication, and how everything was affected. So I think knowing more about the disease will give you, you know, a better viewpoint when you watch that film. So I suggest to everyone here, if you have Netflix, watch that film. It's incredible. So I'm gonna segue back a little bit more to Carly. And I'd like you to tell us a little from the artist's perspective about Nina and about her music, and perhaps some things that the younger generation who is starting to hear a little of her anthems but don't know that much about her should think about her and should know about her and her music.
Absolutely, happy to. And thank you, Sierra, for shining that light on Nina's mental health, because that most certainly informed her work and the way that she created her art. I saw a couple of people in the chat mention her performances on stage and her behavior. She was notorious for calling people out in the audience for, you know, talking during her performances or not respecting the craft, so to speak. And I think it's also really important, and Angela can speak more to this, but she is the official historian on the panel, but I think it's also really important to remember the times in which she was living in. Even if you didn't have a mental health issue, she was in the midst of that work, of that activism work. And she actually talks about, after the death of Martin Luther King, she wrote the song Why, and the Why the King of Love is Dead. And I, if you have any time to look at that performance on YouTube, she actually talks about all of her friends who have passed, all of her friends who have been killed. And you can just hear the trauma and she's grieving, she's mourning, as everybody was during that time. But she was like really in the throes of that work. So on top of that, she had bipolar disorder that was not diagnosed. And so, you know, imagine the triggers that she had. And the great thing about Nina is that she had her music to channel that through. And that is what we all know her for. But I do want to start at the very beginning. We talked about her growing up in North Carolina, and her mother worked, and she was in the church. She was a church leader. She was a preacher, and she grew up around, you know, revivals and gospel music, and that definitely informed her very early musical style. She also was a child prodigy. She started playing piano at a very, very early age. Her favorite composer was Johann Sebastian Bach. And she talks about that quite a bit, that is one of her most earliest influences. So she had this home life where she was hearing the sounds of the church with tambourines and, you know, and the singing and the harmonies, those thick harmonies that you know from gospel music. Yet she also was taking private lessons from an English woman, a British woman that was living in the town of Tryon, had taken her in because she was literally a child prodigy. Everyone saw the musical genius in this little black girl. And as Angela mentioned earlier, you know, her name was Eunice Wayman at the time. And so little Eunice was a child prodigy and was taken in. There's a very famous story about her playing a recital in the town of Tryon, and her parents, she refused to play until her parents were moved from the segregated balcony to the very front row. So Nina has always been feisty, has always, I mean, from a very young age, and demanded excellence and respect from everyone. And she actually, the town galvanized around her and helped raise funds to send her to Juilliard for a summer when she was a young teen. After that, you heard in the video that she later wanted to attend Curtis Institute of Music, which if some of you aren't familiar with Curtis, Curtis is the spot for child prodigies. It's the spot for, I mean, Juilliard and Curtis are right here hand in hand, very well-respected conservatory where the greats are made, so to speak. They ran out of funds at Juilliard, so she had to stop her lessons there, but then she applied to Curtis and did not get in. She believes this is due to her race and attributes that her not getting in was due to her race at that time. Her dream was to be a classical pianist. That was her dream. She wasn't a singer for most of her childhood. That was not what she was a pianist. And she wanted to change the world of classical music. And she had the talent to do so. When she was in Philly, which is where Curtis Institute is, she started singing at bars and to make some extra money. And you heard the story in the video. One of the managers said, well, you can't just play music. You have to sing something. Like, nobody wants to hear you just play piano. Because it's a bar. And so she started singing. And, you know, if you listen to Nina Simone's music, her voice is not liquid gold. She is not necessarily what you would call a polished vocalist, but that's what makes Nina Simone's music so authentic. And you can hear the struggle in her, literally, you can hear the civil rights movement in her voice, to me, that's what I believe. So she started singing, and it's interesting, her classical music background really does inform her very early sounds. Her first hit was I Loves You, Porgy, which is from the Gershwin opera, Porgy and Bess, but many jazz standards of I Loves You, Porgy, of course, have come about, and it's well known as a jazz standard now. That was her first big hit. And she also did a lot of kind of poppy sounds like Love Me or Leave Me, My Baby Don't Care For Me, and all of these songs that you might know. Feeling Good was a part of her early years. So we all know that song, Birds Flying High, we all know that. It's been covered by everybody you can think of. Michael Bublé did not create that song, okay? So anyway, she started out, you know, singing very poppy tunes. And as you heard in the video, she went under the name of Nina Simone when she started singing in the bars. And because she, from the church, her mama and her family were very religious and thought that was the devil's music. That was not what you have been given this gift to do. You have been given this gift to serve God, as you know, as many people in the church will say. And so later on, though, as she started performing everywhere, she also performed at the Newport Folk Festival. She has a very famous performance there. Little Liza Jane is the performance that she performed there. So she was in touch with, I think what's interesting about Nina Simone is her intersectionality with different genres. So a lot of people classify her as a jazz artist, and she
did not like being called a jazz artist. She believed, as she is famously quoted saying, that jazz is the term that white people put on Black people because they don't know how to categorize it. That's what she used to say. She said that if anything, the blues and folk are more in her singing than anything else. And if you listen to her full book of music, you definitely hear that, because folk is all about storytelling. It's all about singing from the community's perspective. And as she got older, and what we know Nina Simone for now is her music during the civil rights movement. She was very, very in your face with how she felt about what was going on to her people. And although she was no longer in North Carolina, she was up north. That's still her home. She's still, and many, many, many musicians from that time period had moved up from North Carolina and from the South. We see this in John Coltrane's music. We see this in all sorts of different people's music, where they were making music to speak to what was going on at the time and what was happening to their people, because they felt it was their duty. You know, Nina Simone has a famous quote that I'm always saying, but an artist's duty is to reflect the times. An artist's duty is to reflect the times. And you can go and find that interview where she says that. And she says, you know, if you're not doing that, what are you doing? And it's because she looked at her art, she looked at her music as a tool, as a powerful, powerful tool. You heard her talking about the electric feeling she feels when she knows she's got the audience. So imagine if you have that powerful gift in the middle of a civil rights movement, right? And she was very famous for being close to Malcolm X and his family. She was at some, you know, folks that write about that time period would categorize her as militant, right? She was all about get out there and fight. And you can see that in her words in Mississippi Goddamn. Definitely, definitely check that entire performance out. She has a couple of performances on YouTube. What's sad about that song is that it resonates so much even today. I mean, you just have to replace this, you know, that's the saddest part about her music is that a lot of it still resonates with us very much. Of course, she had, and that was written right after, you know, the For the Old Girls bombing. And she talks about that. But it calls out the racist that we know from political history. You know, she talks about Wallace, and she talks about, I mean, she calls folks out by name. She was so courageous. And maybe that part of that was her bipolar disorder. I don't know. But I do know that she was more vocal and unabashedly in people's face about what was happening to her people. And that's what we know her for now. You know, she's got other songs. I wish I knew how it felt to be free. That's another very important song of hers. Young, Gifted, and Black. That was literally sung at all the HBCUs across the country. You know, everyone knew the words of that. You know, she also was famous for covering songs like Strange Fruit, which was originally sung by Billie Holiday in the 30s, but brought that back. She sings and, you know, much of her music is now covered. So, you know, you want to relate it to today and this generation. I mean, I was just chatting with some of the women on this call earlier. And I think what's important for folks of my generation and younger to remember is that Feeling Good, you may not have known that was Nina Simone, but you do now. So it's really important to pass that along for this woman to get credit for what she has created. Many of our hip hop artists of these days have covered or sampled her music. Jay-Z in 444, his latest album, The Story of OJ, he samples four women that boom, 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 boom. That is Nina Simone. That is the iconic, that is four women. And you can even hear her song, My Skin is Black. You can hear it in the song with Jay-Z rapping over it. I mean, yes, and it's a, they don't sample it just to sample it. Like that's, if you know what the story of OJ, that song is about, then you understand why he sampled that song. You know, Common sampled her music. Talib Kweli sampled her song Sinner Man for Get By, Just to Get By, you know. So a lot of our socially conscious rappers and hip hop artists are sampling Nina Simone's music because they know her to be what I call an artivist. And I'm not sure if Nina Simone was alive right now, she might tell me that was really corny and don't call her that. So that's just me. But to me, an artivist is someone who uses their art for activism or for social change. And that's exactly what Nina Simone did. And what's kind of sad, what's brave about her story is that she was selling all kinds of records when she was singing about Love Me or Leave Me and My Baby Cares For Me and all these like feel good songs. And when she started singing and speaking the truth about what was happening to her people, even her husband, who was her manager at the time, kept saying, you know, you need to stop making this music and go back to singing pop, because they're going to stop selling your records. They're going to stop playing you on the radio. They're going to stop. And they did. They did. But she didn't care. She felt like it was her duty. An artist's duty is to reflect the times. And that is why she was driven away. She was driven away to Paris and Liberia. She had a stint in Liberia. She wanted to go to the place where her people were free, that they created. And she is iconic. I can't think of another artist in our American music canon that has been so prolific, incredibly prolific, has in a huge book of music. And I think also she was not just intersectional with different disciplines of music. And you can hear her classical training in a lot of this as well. You can, because her piano is just as on point as her lyrics. She stayed an incredible pianist. She demanded excellence from her band, and there are famous stories of her bipolar, what we now know to be her fits, not just on stage, but in the studio and in rehearsals. But she demanded perfection because she demanded perfection of herself. And so her music is a very high caliber. She only worked with the best instruments, instrumentalists and musicians. And she would never allow anyone to box her into any kind of a label. That I think is what our generation of artists can learn from her, you know, is authenticity is what makes you iconic. Authenticity is what makes your music connect to people through generations. And using your gifts and your powerful tool of being able to connect to people for good, you know, for what's going on in the world. And that's exactly what she did. To her, some people would say to her detriment, but I'm not sure if she'd say that now, you know. I'm not sure if she'd say that was to her detriment. She ended up, you know, losing much of her money and all of that. But at the same time, like she did what she had to do in her eyes. Yeah. You know, that's what she had to do. So I definitely, it's very interesting listening to Sierra talk about bipolar disorder. I definitely can see, and I'm sure, you know, Angela and I had an opportunity to really develop a great rapport with her daughter while she was here, and talking to her about her mother was really interesting. As you can imagine, not finding out that she was sick until later in life is, you know, definitely hard, but also answers a lot of questions as to what it was that Lisa went through and what we saw on stage and all of her very rash decisions. I'm going to move to Liberia. I'm going to make a song about Mississippi, goddamn, and I don't care who cares. You know, she was very, and I'm glad for that, because we would not have the Nina Simone that we know and love without that part of her.
It's true. That sort of moves us actually into one of the questions I saw in the chat, and this may be something, Sierra, you can speak to. So there was a question here about whether or not there's a correlation between creativity and mental illness.
So, and I'm really glad that someone asked that, because I meant to put that in my presentation. So thank you. But yes, there actually is. They say that like people who are really artistically inclined are far more likely than like the general population to be experiencing some sort of mental illness. And when you think about mental illness and how it kind of is a shift in the way that we normally are thinking about reality, it makes sense that it would also lend to creativity and lend to the ability to see the world in a different way. So yes, 100%.
Gina, should I just keep going down? There's another one here. Are there long-term effects associated with bipolar medication?
I'm also glad that was asked. Actually, there are. It depends on the medication that's being taken, and it also depends on the person that's taking the medication, and also how much communication they're having with their doctor. One of the medications that really kind of comes to mind for me when it comes to bipolar disorder is lithium. And lithium is technically a type of salt. It's like lithium carbonate and lithium chloride, all that stuff. It's a type of mineral. And so in our bodies, it helps us to think a little bit clearer. It helps with like brain chemistry and making things work better up here. But then when it comes to the rest of our body, it can actually be highly toxic. And so a person that is taking lithium, they need to get regular blood work to make sure their kidneys are okay, to make sure the levels are safe in their bloodstream. And that's something that is different for each and every person, because what could be toxic for one person could be therapeutic for another. So that's why it's so important for people who choose medications to be in regular contact with their psychiatrist. Because if something is going wrong, you need to let someone know so that it can be altered, or it can be tweaked, or it can be changed altogether. But if you don't speak up while you're getting medication management, it can actually be really, really bad for your health.
Okay, thank you.
And I was just going to add in, that's usually when people stop taking their medication. They start getting these extra symptoms and side effects. They start taking it, and then the bipolar is back in its stages. So.
Exactly.
Right.
Well, may I leave us with a quick offering?
Sure.
From a historical perspective. Okay. Yes. So I just wanted us to challenge our brains to think about Nina Simone in a bit of a different way. And Carly alluded to this earlier. I think this is a conversation about both and, right? So certainly bipolar disorder affected her life, but it is not the only piece of her life experience that shaped who she was and why she moved through the world the way that she did. And as Carly stated, Nina Simone lived in her truth she exercised her gifts, but that work pushed her to the margins. Nina Simone spent a lifetime living on the margins from birth to death. Tryon, North Carolina is one of the most beautiful places I have ever been. It's tucked in the foothills of the Blue Ridge Mountains. I joke every time I drive there, if fairies had a place to live, this would be it. It's stunning. It's a resort town. And when you drive in on the main strip, that's what you see, the charm, the train depot, the resort town, right? However, the Black community is on the margins of Tryon. It's unlike many areas where, you know, an MLK Boulevard might indicate where the Black community is. The Black community is tucked far, far, far away. You can't even see it. There's no roads or no signage to indicate where it was. Nina Simone's mother, in addition to being a preacher, was a maid, right? So her Black life was rendered invisible except in the service to white people. Same thing with her father. He was a handyman. Again, Nina Simone lived, grew up in the margins, tucked away from most everyone in Tryon, North Carolina. She was a child prodigy, and that life taking piano lessons rendered her on the margins, meant she couldn't play with kids in her community because she was doing lesson after lesson after lesson. Also meant she was walking into unfamiliar territory. Little Black girl in the margins, right? White space, taking lessons with this British woman. She was later sent to boarding school in Asheville, little over an hour away. Again, on the margins, isolated from folks. Goes to Juilliard, tries to get into Curtis, can't. And so what does she do to make a living? She's playing in bars in Atlantic City on the margins, trying to use her gifts and her talents to live. She later takes off in her career, is a pop artist, but where is that happening? She's one of the only Black people holding space in pop music at the time. She's on the margins. She enters a relationship with a man who becomes her manager and later her abuser on the margins. She cannot ask for help. Her circle is this circle of activists who Carly described as militant. People did not like that on the margins. Again, even her family, her husband. That work later rendered her without a career on the margins. And so I think that Nina Simone, again, was courageous in living her truth. And that life on the margins, she deserved to be angry. She deserved to speak out, because again, how awful to live a life, again, constantly on the margins. I can't imagine it.
Well, I want to thank everyone that presented tonight. This was an excellent presentation. We learned a lot about Nina Simone. We learned a lot about her struggles and her triumphs, which are both. I do encourage everyone to continue to read about her. I encourage everyone, I think Sandy put it in earlier in the chat, the National Trust for Historic Preservation. I'm going to be forward and say, make a donation. You know, there's a need out there, and we do need to support the efforts that are preserving our history. So I do think that's very important. Other people are putting stuff in the presentation. So Carol, do you want to end?
I think this was an absolutely wonderful evening. And I think Angela did sum it up in the end that we looked at Nina Simone, the person and the artist and all that she was going through. And so if any of us were in a situation with that type of, you know, abuse and that type of environment, what would it may we have become? So I think we need to recognize that there are a lot of people who are hurting today. I was a therapist for many years at Johns Hopkins Bayview, and work with mental health, and that's not something that we in the Black community talk about. Oh no, girl, you don't go to counseling, you don't go to therapists, and they never understood quite why we couldn't get a lot of Black clients. I said, because we don't trust you. And the Black community does not trust mental illness as something's for real, because we were not permitted to have that. So because we couldn't, our families didn't have it, it was not okay to talk about. So I think we need to talk about this more and more and more. I think Megan's little discussion she had this week kind of highlighted again that mental illness is for real and we all need to take it seriously and get help for people. So I thank you so much for all your information. And yes, please make donations. Thank you so much. Sandy, are you around?
Sandy had to leave real quick.
Okay, so thank you so much. And this will be it. Unless there's some other questions, I think.
Any other questions?
I see comments, but not a lot of questions. And so, and I think Angela's put her how to reach her in the chat. And we have also the other information in the chat. So if anyone wants it, please let us know. Please do the survey. We do need the feedback so we'll know how we can improve the next program that we do. And thank you for coming.
Thank you for having us.
Good night, thank you.
Thank you, good night, everyone.
Good night. Good night.
I need to write down these email addresses.
Yes. Very good, Gina.
That was. I got them real.
Great job.
Very informative.
Yes.
Very. I think you know.
I just want to say this was a great job. I am so glad I was included in the number. And I want to tell you girls, good night. I am done. I'm toast right now.
Good night.
Okay, good night. All right.
You laying down.
May your nights be filled with pink and green crescents.
Thank you, Madam President.
Yeah, you did a very good job.
Thank you very, very, very much.
Yeah, very good.
As usual, excellent job, Target 2 and Target 4.
Thank you.
Sierra, did that go well?
It went well.
I said, Sierra, didn't you feel comfortable? That was very good.
I did feel 100% comfortable. I'm just amazed at how amazing you guys are. It's not really often that I get a chance to be around so many like really talented, like skilled Black women. So it's like, you're like contain my excitement. I'm like, oh my goodness.
Well, particularly in that profession, because there are not a lot of Black therapists. So
really isn't.
When you find one, you go, oh my God, there's another one. So yeah.
Exactly.
At Bayview, there were like maybe a handful of Black therapists. And-